I've been doing a theme the last couple of weeks on God. God is, you know, God is almighty. God is all powerful. God is our refuge. God is our strength. God is faithful. There's so many things God is that the Bible reveals. I think it's that phrase is in the Bible like 173 times. But this morning, we're going to look at the phrase, God is with us. And you know, that's what Christianity is all about, is having a relationship with God. And it's not about church. Church is a blessing. It's where all Christians hang out and fellowship and encourage one another. The Bible says not to forsake the assembling of ourselves, even much more so as you see the day approaching. But the main thing is knowing God, knowing that you have a relationship with Him. And, you know, when man fell in the garden and disobeyed God, the Bible says, because of one man's sin, many became sinners. So because of one man's disobedience, everybody who was born after him was born into sin. But God wanted to restore mankind because He loves us and He wants to have a relationship with us. That's the way He created us. And if we don't have God in our lives, we aren't complete. We're empty. We're always trying to fill a void in our lives with things and people and relationships and money and all these things. We're trying to fill that void. And even the richest person sometimes is just totally unhappy. Because when he dies, he can't take a thing with him. He'll die just like that man, that homeless guy on the streets, living on the streets. He'll die the exact same way. But God loved us so much. He loved His creation so much that He wanted to redeem them from the fall. That means buy them back. And so for thousands of years in the Old Testament, there was 330 prophecies about the coming of the Messiah that would save people and redeem them from the fall and restore them into a relationship with God, the way that He created for them to have. And so there was 330 prophecies throughout the Old Testament about Christ coming. Isaiah said that He would be born of a virgin and He would be wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our lawless deeds, and the chastisement of His peace would be upon us, and with His stripes we are healed. He said those things 700 years before Christ came on this earth. And all 330 prophecies came to fulfillment. And the chances of that happening, the chances for 330 prophecies throughout over a couple thousand years being fulfilled exactly the way they were said, is like you winning the lottery 11 times in the roll. That's the chances of that happening. And if you do, make sure you tithe. But that ain't gonna happen. It's like, I heard somebody say, it's like finding a quarter, one certain quarter in a football field of quarters. That's the way the odds would be of this happening. But the Bible says that in the fullness of time, in God's right timing, Jesus was manifested. And the Bible says, John said, the Word became flesh and dwelled among us. In other words, all the prophecies of the Old Testament became flesh and dwelled among us. And God was manifested in the flesh. Jesus was the Son of God manifested in the flesh. He was God in the flesh. And the Pharisees and Sadducees said, if you just show us God, it will satisfy us. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And so Christ came to buy us back. He was the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the earth. Right there in Genesis, right there in the fall, when man fell, God had a promise for mankind. He says, I'm going to raise up one whose seed is going to defeat the devil, and his heels will bruise his head. And so right there, Christ, God was saying that God is going to restore what was lost in the fall. So God wants to be with us. And how can you tell if he's with you? Well, you all probably came with somebody in the car, and you know somebody's with you. You know when nobody's in the car, but you know when somebody's in the car. And you know when God is with you and when he's not. Because you're empty. You have no hope. The only hope you have is in this world and in government and money and in things and in people. But God, with a relationship with him, he is your hope. I want to show you an old video. How many know who James Stewart is? That's what I thought. Probably one or two people. But he's an old actor, and he did this nativity scene about God with us, and I want you to watch this. Oh, no, the computer's not on. It's got to see me. Got it. Okay.
Kruger, I'm custodian over at the Beck Apartments, but you know that, don't you? You know that. I guess nobody here can see me or hear me except you. You. I didn't bring a gift, but I guess that's not important. Thank you for everything you've done for me. As long as I can remember, you've been right by my side. I'll never forget when you walked with me right in those first few hours after I lost Martha. I have always been able to count on you when I felt dark inside, and you were right there, right every time. Right there. Even when I didn't feel good about myself, I knew that you cared for me enough, and that made me feel better. Like the time I got mad with Mabel Huntington because she broke her pipes on purpose, just so she could have somebody to see while I came up and fixed them for her. Boy, I hollered at her. Boy, I hollered real loud. But then I got to thinking. You love Mabel just as much as you love me, and I should treat her the way you want me to. I believe I talked to you about that at the time. I started visiting her, and we became friends, and I saw her almost every day until the day she died. I love you. You're my closest, my finest friend, and that means that I can hold my head high wherever I go. Thank you.
I can tell that God was with him. He had a relationship with God. And so the greatest, I won't keep you long this morning, the greatest gift that you could receive this Christmas is Jesus Christ with you. And if you don't know him, because he's coming back for those who know him, and it's coming, getting really close, because you could see the way the world's just coming together and forming all this one world stuff. And he's coming back. And it might be tomorrow. It might be the next day. It might even be today. And so you want to know him. You want to know him because God's coming back for those who know him. And even if he doesn't come back for 20 years, you don't want to do life without him. Amen. Because he is a very present help in time of trouble. God is my refuge. God is my strength, a very present help in time of trouble. He wants to be your refuge. He wants to be your help. He wants to be your friend, and he wants to walk alongside of you. And so let's just pray this morning and close with prayer. Everybody close their eyes, and I just want to ask you this question. Is God with you? Is he with you? Do you know that he's with you? We're not talking about church attendance, not talking about being good. I just want to know, is he with you this morning? Because that's the greatest question you have to answer in this lifetime. And you have to know that he's with you. And if you want him to be with you this morning, I just want you to raise your hand. And I want to pray with you this morning. And if you've never accepted the Lord Jesus in your life, he's there and he's wanting to come into your life. You don't have to clean yourself up. You don't have to do any good works. All you have to do is say, yes, Lord, come into my life. The Bible says in Romans, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice, I will come into him and fellowship with him. In other words, be with him and he with me. So all you have to do is pray this prayer. And then once you do that, you want to get in church. You want to be around other Christians so you can grow and know the Lord in a greater way. But if you want the Lord in your life this morning, just pray this prayer with me. Hey, Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins and cleanse me by your blood. And I ask you to come into my life so you would be with me all the days of my life and you will become my strength and my Lord and my refuge and my helper and my friend in Jesus' name. And if you prayed that prayer this morning, you've received the greatest gift that you will ever get on this earth. Money can't buy it. Good works can't get it. Only God can give it to you this morning. So if you've received that this morning, you have received the greatest gift on earth. Bill Gates couldn't buy you a better gift than was given here in church this morning. I said, Bill Gates couldn't buy you. And he's got money to buy all kinds of things, but he can't buy you salvation. Only Jesus gives it freely. It's a free gift. It's a free gift. Most of you will be getting gifts today that you really don't deserve. You've kind of been on the naughty list, but your mom's going to give you something anyway. God gave us a gift that we really don't deserve, but it was by grace through faith that we receive it. Lord bless you and have a great, great Christmas. Thank you for coming out today.